Hi everybody, welcome to another how-to video with Kodaster and Salome Mecca. And today we're going to talk about nonlinear time history dynamic analysis. And we're going to use one of the models that we used during the last two examples. What I want to do is to introduce a nonlinearity in this model, a simple nonlinearity. And then in the following up video, we will see how we can do a dynamic substructuring of the structure so that we can substructure the linear part of the structure and have only the nonlinear part time integration scheme. And this will reduce the analysis time considered very much. So in this video, I'm just going to explain how I have set up this nonlinear dynamic analysis. As I said, it's something very simple. I just wanted to do very few modifications, also not changing the mesh at all. So my idea was to introduce nonlinearity at the base of the structure and have the contact and separation effect, so eventually, essentially, the structure can rock, can overturn, and we can have compression resistance in compression, and no resistance, no stiffness in tension. Okay, so and to show you here, we are going to introduce at the base some point elements which I wanted to show part. We increase this parameter, we can see that at the base of the structure where we have the nodes, we have these points that are the point discrete elements. And we're going to see how we can set this up. Let's jump in to the input file. This is the input file that I used. It's a modification of the previous ones, the linear analysis. So in the beginning, we have some constant values. Here, as before, are more or less the same. We are introducing the stiffness, compression stiffness that we want to use in our elements. And this is a value that you have to evaluate maybe before, so for example, also with applying the gravity loads, you can see how much tension you have. This is a value that one has to evaluate, let's say. There is no correct value. And we're going to use 10 modes for the dumping. So we are going to use a 5% dumping for all the first 10 modes of the model. Now let's go and see what we have changed. Okay, so essentially we have we are reading the mesh in the beginning, and then we're using this new command that is crea mayas. So we are creating a new mesh. We have to create a new mesh because we want to define these new discrete elements that they were not before. One can also find them in the mesh module, so you don't have to do this step. But as I said, I didn't want to change the med file, so the med file is the same as before, and I'm just modifying it in Kodaster. And I am saying with this command, I am saying that I want the nodes that are in these two groups, so essentially at the base of the columns of the walls, to create these are called 0D elements or POI 1. That's the language, let's say. And we're going to name this new group contact base. So this group has all the discrete elements, and we're going to use this group name all over the place. So we can see the difference. We are defining our model. Everything is the same as before. We have slabs and the beam elements. And here we have the discrete elements. We are saying that for this group that we defined before, we have a modelization of a discrete DST and the mechanic phenomena. for the discrete elements, there is a very interesting document, that is this one, where you can see what behaviors there are, nonlinear behaviors for discrete elements. Of course, there are also other documents general for the discrete elements. Essentially, in this case, we have a 0D discrete element. What does this mean? This means that if we can think a discrete element as a two-node element, the second node that is fixed, let's say, on the ground, you don't actually see it. So you are defining everything on the node that belongs to the structure. So these elements are always used as a external, let's say, support, external element to the structure. They cannot be used to connect two elements together. For this, you would need the line discrete element. Okay, so we go, then we have to define the characteristics of the elements before. Here we have this new part that is discrete and the orientation. Okay, so we are saying that for each discrete element, this is the definition for the stiffness, this definition for the mass that it can carry. This is the definition for the damping. And these, I just put them there as placeholders to show how we can define them, but as you see, the values are zero. The only value that is non-zero is this stiffness that we are defining. And as you can see here, I am putting the stiffness in the x direction, which I say that is the local x-axis. Now, if this was a line element, the local x-axis always in the direction, let's say, that connects the two nodes. In this case, we have to define the local axis. If you don't define them, then they are equal to the global axis. But since we want to be precise and to know what we're doing, we are going to say that we're going to use a local axis, and then here we're going to orient this local axis. Another thing here, for example, the fact that this n means that we have 0d elements for a node, otherwise it can be l, for example, for line element, and d stands for the diagonal part. So essentially what we are doing here with these three stiffnesses is like we have three independent springs in the three orthogonal directions. There are also possibilities that you can define the whole stiffness matrix between degrees of freedom of discrete element. Okay, and so we're giving this stiffness, and then we have to orient, and we're going to use this option. There are different options for orienting. So here we're going to say that we're going to define the x local axis and the y local axis. And this is going to be with six values series, three values for x and three values for y. And as you can see here, the x is along the z direction, as we said, and is facing down. So this is important, because this means that this is where it's going to be contact. Otherwise, you would have, if it was positive, you would have the contact uplift, no resistance in the direction, let's say, in the gravity direction. Okay, then we have the material of concrete. And here we have the material of contact elements. So the discrete elements, they don't have a material per se, as we said, the stiffness, find it per car LM. But here we have to give him the, for the state, we have to tell the nonlinear behavior that we want. And this nonlinear behavior in this case is this contact, and we are defining a stiffness in pressure that is normal to the direction. There are also other options. You can have the stiffness lateral, you can have some damping, you can have friction, and but this is the simplest let's say approach. And as you can see, in the end we're using twice this stiffness. Of course, this is going to be used if we have linear element, linear model. When we were doing the model analysis, we're using this stiffness. When we're doing the nonlinear analysis, we can specify this behavior. Then we have to assign these materials. Everywhere we're going to assign concrete, and at the discrete elements contact base, contact. Okay, now I'm going to define the support conditions of the structure. And if you see here, I don't have the Z direction. So as we said, the Z direction stiffness comes from discrete elements. Every other direction is blocked. Then we have the weight. As always, we can calculate the mass and result table. And then we can assemble our stiffness matrices. Everything is as done before, and we are calculating the modes. And we put the result in our med file. Then we are defining our analysis. We're going to say that we're going to do just one step. From minus one, we're going to start the analysis, to zero for gravity analysis. And then we're going to do a time history and linear dynamic analysis with a time step of 0.01. And then we have the function for the weight, that is a ramp function that then stays constant. Then we are loading the acceleration, and as you can see, for example, the previous videos for that. I don't want to spend so much time, but essentially we are loading the files for the acceleration, and then we are multiplying by the mass so that we have the inertial forces directions. Okay, and then here we have the static analysis for gravity. So we're using stat nonline. We have element, the material, and here is one of the important keywords, the comportement, that is the behavior. And typically you want to include a tutui with the main, let's say, elastic relation, that everywhere you have elastic, and then you're going to overwrite where you want to have a nonlinear. In this case, I have a small displacement theory, everything is small deformations, and at the discrete elements, I'm going to assign this nonlinear behavior, this chalk fold. Essentially, this is also used as a shock absorber element, because you can have stiffness, but compression, but you can have also some damping if needed. And we have the excitation and the increment. And then when we do this analysis, we're going to set up a nonlinear dynamic analysis. This part is exactly the same. Here we're telling Codaster that the initial state is not zero, but we have to take it from static analysis. We have the excitations with loads and functions. Here we're saying about the model damping. So same damping for all the modes. We have the time uh, time step that we want to use and up to what time we want, let's say, to do the analysis, if we want to finish before the time that we have assigned. Here I'm saying that I want to exclude the velocity field, so I'm reducing the field that I want to have. This is up to you. And finally, we have to tell him something about the time integration scheme that we want to use. And again, here, if we go to the documentation, Dyna Nonlinear, you can see about the solvers. And here there is also a description of what you can use, what you cannot use. In this case, we're going to use a Hilbert-Hughes-Taylor schema, which is used with these keywords. And this is a pretty stable schema, especially if you have nonlinearity. It is introducing some numerical damping, so one should be careful, let's say, what he gets out of the model. But in general, especially when you have contact behavior, it can have much better results. Because, for example, with the standard Newmark method, you will get a lot of, let's say, chattering response. Okay, so we're doing this analysis, and then everything is the same as the other times. We are getting the displacement. Okay, so with that, let's see what response we get. This takes about 20 minutes in my computer to run, so it's not much, but the model is quite small. If you had a bigger model, I mean, it would start to be, let's say, kind of a problem. But okay, it depends, let's say, on your requirements. As you can see, the structure is rotating. Just to show here that I'm using a real-time sequence in the animation view that you can access right-click here. If you don't have it on your screen, you can select real-time, and we have 15 seconds of analysis, and I'm saying that I want to see these 15 seconds in 30 seconds. So we are watching a video that is half time, let's say, of real-time. And you can see clearly that there is some uplift going on. And let's go also to see our response in the Jupyter Lab. This is also something that I'm going to give you. So that you can see the results easier. Okay, we are here in the nonlinear dynamic analysis. So these are the time histories of the acceleration. This is the response that we get. These are the minimum and the maximum in the two directions of the roof, the average roof displacement, so the minimum, the maximum, the average roof displacement. And here I'm also plotting a comparison with the linear response. And one thing that we can see is that this direction doesn't change much. So in the y direction, we don't have so much difference. The nonlinear effects are not so much evident. Here, they are more evident, you see some difference, and also what you see is that the nonlinear response usually is a little bit on the right respect, so you have a period that is, when you have the nonlinear response, the period, let's say, is increasing structure. Last but not least, I would like to show the SDK. So essentially what you're going to have from GitHub, the SDK, an export file that you can open with, so you will download the export file, you can import it as export.sdk, and you will have this. So here, let's explain a little bit what we see. Here we have the command file given, the med file that is given, and these are the unit numbers that are important when they are given in the command file, so they have to match. Here we have the two acceleration files, and then we have the results, the mesh file. We have the log, we can see what happened in our analysis if there are some problems. So we have the modal analysis results, the seismic results, these are always on the mesh, so RMed, and then we have two TXT files with modal results, the frequencies essentially, and the participation factors, and the seismic results that we extracted and that we were showing here. Essentially here we are opening this seismic tool. So I think that we have covered everything that I wanted. This is a simple nonlinear analysis, dynamic nonlinear analysis for a structure, and in the next video we're going to see how we can reduce the time for this analysis by using substructuring. Thank you for watching. Bye.